call this address the advance of the papacy from the 20th century to modern times, to give the Catholic the gospel with care and with love, we need to understand the history of Catholicism, particularly recent history from the 20th century onwards, and to be able to address the false ecumenism that's taking place not only here in the United States but across the world. We need to understand the history of Catholicism and what has happened in the so-called evangelical world. But how can I talk about the advance of Catholicism when there's been so many scandals in the Catholic Church and decline of priests and nuns? Just before coming here, I was interviewed from a radio station in Rochester, upstate New York, asking about the scandals, and in particular about 13 schools that were closed down in the Rochester area. 13 Catholic schools because of these scandals. Now, these scandals have hit not just Rochester, but even two dioceses in Portland, Oregon, and Spokane, Washington. We have had two dioceses going bankrupt because of the scandals. Another diocese in California paying $60 million to the victims of those who had been, sodomites, priests going after young children. It is really sad. I replied that the ordinary Catholic does not have a means. Theoretically, they have the parish council, and the parish council can go to the Archdiocesan Council and then to the Vatican, but that does not work. The Vatican is a power structure that is emphatic that it's going to advance, and it has advanced. And even with the decline of the numbers of the priests that recently came out, again a huge decline, and of nuns and of religious brothers, and with these huge scandals, even with the two big archdioceses, like for example of Portland and Spokane going bankrupt because of the scandals, and $60 million being spent, was it down in San Diego, because of the scandals. You know, even huge problems, the Catholic Church continues to advance. And mostly even in numbers of many more Catholics than before. Why is there this advance? What is the power structure? And what is the intrigue? And what is the cause? What is the practical wisdom that we need to decipher how the Catholic Church advances amidst all of these things? And that's what we want to deal with tonight. Now, to understand the Vatican, we have to understand that it is not simply a religious body, it's also a political body. Wonderfully portrayed in the book of Revelation as the woman that rides the beast. The woman, the religious system, riding the political system. What believers saw, like the Vaudois, the Albigenses, and the Waldenses, and the believers of old saw right through history, and of course through the 305 years of the Inquisition, believers always saw, and they lived under, the woman that rides the beast. But nowadays is seldom seen. The political side, it's the political side where the main power of the Catholic Church comes from. It's in political control. Now, the Vatican was restored to its political status in the year 1929. It was Benito Mussolini gave back power, civil power, the Vatican Hill and parts of Rome to the Catholic Church, that it could rule there as a civil authority. That was an amazing move because it healed what had happened years before. The Vatican, through much of its years, going back to the earliest times in the Catholic Church, from the 8th century onwards, going into the 9th, 10th century, where it got control of land and eventually became the papal states, it was controlling a big portion of Italy. Then in the year 1870, two colossal things happened. 1870, the famous Pio Nono. You see pictures of him and you can see the oozing pride and arrogance of the man, even against his own cardinals and advisors. He got this idea of papal infallibility. And against advice, even from his historians, he went ahead, pushed for a council in which he got declared as an official teaching of the Catholic Church, papal infallibility. It was in July 1870. God will not be mocked. The attribute of infallibility is God's own attribute. God, let God be true and every man a liar, in the words of Scripture. And this was a horrendous decree. It was 2 months later, on September the 20th, that the French withdrew its armies where it had been protecting the papal states. The French had withdrawn their armies from after the papal decree immediately on July the 18th. And then 2 months later, September the 20th, in comes the Nationalist Army and they take Rome. And of course they have overrun Italy and the Papal States were taken from the Pope's power. It lost civil power. But in 1929, Mussolini restores political power. And that was the beginning again of the Catholic Church showing that it's the woman that rides the beast. She uses political power to advance. And she has done so mightily. Not only with Mussolini, but the most infamous concordat, civil concordat, made between the Pope, Pacelli, known as Pius the 12th, and Adolf Hitler, where the German army, over 50% of them Catholic, come up under Hitler, and we have the building up towards the Second World War, and the Vatican intrigue with the whole operation that went towards the Second World War, and of course the annihilation or the trying to annihilate the persecution against the Jews. It was a horrendous time. To this day, the laws of financial aid from Germany still uphold from that decree or concordat made between the Vatican and Adolf Hitler. To this day, money still comes in from Germany to the Vatican. It's amazing the power that the Vatican has had and still has through civil concordats that are legal agreements. A legal agreement between a civil nation and the Vatican as a civil nation. They call it the Holy See. If you're searching on the internet for the Vatican as a civil power, it's called the Holy See. And look under concordats and see how many it has made with different nations. It is just amazing to see what has happened in the concordats that have been made. These concordats are under different headings. Often, what is Christian doctrine, defining what a Christian is in civil law. What is to be recognized as Christianity? What is to be recognized as education? Of course, establishing Catholic education. What is to be recognized as a political policy, Catholic political thought? What is to be realized as regards property rights and negotiating property, appointing bishops? And what is to be regarded as marriage, recognizing marriage and annulments, Catholic control over the marriage bed and its idea of marriage and its control over marriage? These are the sort of things that go into civil law. We're not talking about church law, civil law, the actual law of a nation upheld by the civil authorities. Prior to 1978, there were 85 nations of the world who had civil agreements in this legal format, concordats with Rome, and some just at embassy level. Today, in 2008, there are 176 nations, including the United States of America, who have embassies in the Vatican and have ambassadors from the Vatican coming here to the United States and these other nations. To date, the United States of America does not have a concordat as such, but the Catholics boast in their commentary on the canon law that some of their laws nonetheless are accepted in civil law, and they give examples. In the United States of America, some of their laws are accepted as civil law. On December the 4th, 2007, there's a recent example where in Albania, the nation of Albania accepted Vatican economic policy, and that concluded a concordat that was initially established in the year 2002. The U.S. has these ambassadors then going out to these many nations. When did it happen in the United States? When did the change come about? The United States had broken its relationship that it had previously with the Vatican because the Vatican supported the South in the Civil War. It supported the Confederacy. And the United States, because of that, after the Civil War, decided to drop its ambassadors and civil alliance with the Vatican. Then, on December the 10th, 1984, the conservative President Reagan reinstituted relationship with the Vatican. One congressman objected, one. For the most part, believers did not even know what was happening, let alone protest. If during this year or years to come there's a concordat, believers mightn't even know that such a thing is happening because they're very unconscious of the political power of the Catholic Church and how important it is to understand the political power. When I was in Slovakia talking to some pastors there, a great privilege in the year 2000, some of those pastors were explaining to me how horrendous the year 2000 was, because the nation of Slovakia had just finished a concordat with Rome. And they said, we are not only persecuted already by the Catholic Church, but now it means that the police can turn up at our door to close down our churches. Some of these men with small churches, some 10, 15, 20 people, now fearing the last stage of persecution because the Catholic Church was to have civil power backing them in the nation of Slovakia. I have still been in contact with Slovakia and things have got steadily worse. It's quite interesting to look at the nations who have concordats and to look at how many evangelicals there are in that nation and what's the state of the gospel. Look at Venezuela, for example. Look at Venezuela and see 1% evangelical. as the same from Guatemala, 33% or more. You know, look at the nations where they have civil power behind them and see the difference, and see how the Catholic Church advances because of its civil power. And that we must be conscious as believers that we have a religious system that is also a political system, and that she makes most of it. The Vatican has been wooing Iran, trying to woo even present-day Iran, while at the same time trying to have relationships with Israel. The present Pope, Benedict, is trying to get on board more Islamic states to have concordats with Islam in Islamic states. Some of them have signed on. Others are reluctant, as you might imagine. But they say they have the same faith in Abraham as we have. They proclaim their unity with Islam and are trying to join together with Islamic states. It is just amazing, but this is part of the way that the Vatican has progressed and will continue to progress unless we as believers become aware and begin to be astute regarding what the Vatican policy is. I have a DVD online called Vatican Power Through Vatican Control Through Civil Power. It's something we have to study and really, really try to understand. The Catholic Church has been successful because of the apostasy of people who were purportedly evangelical, and some of them very famous people, going back before the 20th century into the 19th century. We had the apostasy of John Henry Newman, and he started the whole Oxford movement and what is called as the Tractarian movement, the publication of tracts, trying to show through tracts, small tracts that were published, that it is through rituals that salvation comes, and particularly trying to show that the historical approach to the Antichrist was untrue, and that there is a future Antichrist to come. The doctrine of the woman riding the beast was abhorrent to Newman and to the Tractarian Society, and they tried to show that this was not true and tried to get people's minds looking to the future, to a future Antichrist that is to come. And they were quite successful, again, because a lot of the believers at the time were not astute and were not answering these tracts with their own tracts. And the Oxford movement succeeded in to many ways whereby it should not have succeeded. The Oxford movement succeeded also in producing Westcott and Hort, purported Greek scholars. They were also ritualistic Anglicans, believing in a baptismal regeneration and rituals to save you. They did not like the King James Bible or the received text, and they went out of their way to produce another Greek text, that they were going back to older documents. Their one argument was the older the document, the better it is. And of course that, if you know anything about textual criticism and the history of Greek text, that doesn't prove anything. But that was their thesis. And they produced a Greek text that was used for the Standard Revised Version. And that basically is the Greek text that is accepted nowadays by many professors and many pastors. The Nestle Aran text, Greek text, is for the most part Westcott and Hort. How serious is that? Some scholars say it is so serious that there are about 5,600 changes, additions, omissions, and changes to the Greek text. Now others will argue in the number, and others there is great theological debate, you know, as regards details. It is a whole field in itself for examination, but it's something pastors and professors must study. It has helped the progression of the Catholic Church because people have begun doubting their Bibles. Which translation do you use? It has devolved into like the Message so-called Bible, which is Gnostic and mystical, or to things like the NIV was one of the first declines, you know, a very good paraphrase of the Bible, but a paraphrase and not really a translation. You know, it has devolved and devolved down to the text that Rick Warren used in his purpose-driven, obnoxious stuff, you know. Let me not be so blunt, but let me say it nicely. It is, you know, and there are some good Greek texts, Greek words, but there are changes, and it goes on and on. Some of the most famous are, for example, in the Westcott Hort, the text, the Westcott Hort, it is, when he had by himself purged our sins, Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3, by himself is left out of the Greek. It was in the original received text that the believers always had, but it's not in that. And it's not in most of the Bible translations, even of the ones that are quite good in other aspects. Another example is James 5:16, confess your faults to one another. The word in Greek is distinctly false. Many of these modern translations say confess your sins to one another. Of course, that's what the Catholics want to hear. That fits in with Catholic doctrine. And we could go on and on, but that's a whole study in itself, that the upholding of Catholicism as the very Bible is challenged, and the text that believers upheld throughout the centuries, even the Vaudois having the received text and translating it into their own language way before the Reformation. Bible believers at the Reformation discovering the received text that the believers had. One of the main causes of the Reformation was that they knew the exact words of Scripture in the text that the believers always had. And today, people are not even conscious of the problem, let alone able to address it. Now, how did this all happen? It happened by a legal mandate of the British government going back to 1829, when the Jesuits were allowed back legally into Britain. They had been forbidden in Britain because of their machinations. The word Jesuitry, you know, sounds bad when somebody is into Jesuitries or into, you know, twisting and turning things. And even legally they were not accepted in Britain. But that was changed, whereby the Catholic Emancipation Act in 1829, and then it was in 1833 that we had the whole Newman defection and the Tractarian Society. And then the whole Westcott and Hort thing. It was because Bible believers were not conscious of the ramifications of political decisions that the English government made, and how the believers had stood strong politically in the past. They did not do so when the Jesuits got back into the UK. Now, the Vatican has increased in leaps and bounds because people no longer see her as the woman riding the beast. She has succeeded not just because of Westcott and Hort, and the Tractarian movement, but most of all because of others who've got into futurism. The Jesuits had tried to get people's minds off papal Rome being the fulfillment of 2 Thessalonians 2 and Revelation 17 and 18, and tried to get the minds onto the future by Francisco Rivera at the time of the Reformation. For 200 years they tried, many famous Jesuits, purporting to have different arguments for why there was to be a future Antichrist. And then the famous Manuel Lecunza comes 200 years later, and he writes under a name that is not his own name. He calls himself Ben Yosefet, Ezra Yosefet, converted Jew. A lie. He was a Jesuit, but he called himself a converted Jew. And he wrote the future coming of Messiah in power and glory. I have a copy of the book back in my library. 604 pages. It's frightening to read. So much reminds you of modern day America. Coming from the tribe of Dan, sitting in the temple of Jerusalem in the future, to call himself the one sitting on God's throne, trying to show 2 Thessalonians 2 to be fulfilled in the future. It is frightening to see Manuel Lecunza writing these things that we find so clearly enunciated in things like the Scofield Bible later on. It's frightening. What was more frightening was to see these same things come into the excellent Plymouth Brethren that started under a man who was born again out of Catholicism, John Nelson Darby, and started the Plymouth Brethren, or the Brethren group of churches. And they went south of Dublin and had their prophetic conferences. And from those prophetic conferences, they started to try to analyze who the Antichrist was to be and to come up with futuristic Antichrist and a 3.5 literal year period before he comes back, and of the church being a mere parenthesis. It's like you're reading Manuel Lecunza all over again. Really sad. Really, really sad. And the Brethren have been even more successful in publishing booklets, tracts, than the Oxford movement. And they've been successful in getting others to promote this futurism that has been so so prevalent in furthering Catholicism. It's frightening to see what has happened and happening just before our eyes. I talked about the Scofield Bible, you know, the two different editions of the Scofield Bible that came out, and how it has, page after page, given futurism and endorsed futurism, so that most fundamentalist churches in the United States uphold futurism, because of the Scofield Bible is their Bible, and the notes are like they were inspired of God. It is really, really sad. Sperry Schaefer, who started the Dallas Theological Seminary, also was taken in by this futurism, and so Dallas, and all the many seminaries that Dallas has started. Most of the United States became futuristic. Most Bible-believing churches, and even Grace or Reformed churches, have become futuristic in the United States. Not so Europe, because Europe suffered under the woman that rides the beast. And her history is very sad history, and some of the nations, you know, you can still find museums of torture of the 605 years, you know, of the woman riding the beast, you know, on her torture and burning to death the believers. You know, there's still residue of the history in Europe. And so it has affected Europe, but not to the extent. And of course in Asia, the church has not known it. We spent 1 year in China, and it was lovely to be with the believers who have been untouched by futurism or these ideas. These are all just going back to what is called dispensationalism. Dallas, the Scofield Bible, and Darby, the Oxford movement. It's not found right through history. Nonetheless, futurism is what has ruled in the United States of America. And unless we are conscious of this, we will not be able to stand. I talked to the pastor today because of this, and I changed my talk for tomorrow on mysticism and the emerging church to the biblical uncovering of the Pope and the papacy, where I go into these Bible texts, because I thought I should do a presentation on it. And so even at this late date, we have changed for tomorrow evening. And I think it'll probably be one of the more important addresses that I will give. So we have the Vatican power through futurism that has been so successful, particularly in the United States of America. Then through false ecumenism. The Vatican has thrived and grown because of its false ecumenism with so-called believers. The Vatican's own policy was this, that they should ecumenize with those that before they had called heretics. At Vatican Council II, that met in Rome from 1962 to 1965, what were called heretics before now were separated brethren. And you will see in the footnotes that I give many quotations, whereby they're going to now have dialogue. Before they have dialogue with the believers, they are already in dialogue with Islam, Buddhism, and Hinduism, which before they called pagan religions, and they had nothing to do with. Now they recognize them as ways to God, and recognize Islam as the same faith of Abraham that they have. Horrendous changes in Catholic doctrine and policy, whereby they accept pagan religions and then they start to woo. They start to woo those who are Bible believers. And they say dialogue is not an end in itself, not just an academic discussion. Rather, dialogue serves to transform modes of thought and behavior and daily life in those communities, non-Catholic communities. And in this way, it aims at preparing the way into their unity of faith in the bosom of one church, one and visible. Thus, little by little, as obstacles to perfect ecclesial communion are overcome, all Christians will be gathered in a common celebration of the Eucharist into the unity of the one and only church which Christ bestowed on his church from the beginning. And so they see all churches coming back to the Catholic Church, little by little. And that's how they have succeeded, little by little, step by step. And one of these steps, it wasn't a little step, it was a big step, was the defection by the famous John Stott and J.I. Packer, going back to what happened in Kiel and Nottingham in the United Kingdom. Stott and Packer should have read the Vatican Decree on Ecumenism. It was published in their days. It would have taken about an hour to read or less. It was out there in public domain to be seen and read, but they did not read it. And they went ahead to establish what was to become the Anglo-Roman Catholic International Commission, ARCIC. And they had two conferences in whereby they accepted ritualistic Anglicans and Catholics at Kiel, and then ritualistic Anglicans, Catholics, and Charismatics at Nottingham, officially endorsed. It has been won downhill ever since, and it has gone on and on. Even the secular newspaper, the United Kingdom, the Times newspaper, February 2007, carried a headline, "Churches Back Plan to Unite Under the Pope," showing the Anglican Church going back under the papacy, and of course other churches with them. That has not happened as yet. There's still some obstacles, but it's a highway that has already been established. It has to be finalized. It has been horrendous. And such famous names as J.I. Packer, who's written some of the most splendid works on what is justification by faith alone, through grace alone, in Christ alone. And then in practice, to deny these things in false ecumenism. He did that on that side of the Atlantic, and later on he was to do it on this side by signing some other decrees. It was 17 years after Nottingham that the worst defection took place. Dallas, Texas, 1994. I remember the exact day, I think it was the day afterwards I got the news of it. 20 leading evangelicals, 20 leading Catholics signed an agreement called Evangelicals and Catholics Together, the Christian Mission in the Third Millennium. It has been disastrous. They purported that Catholics are our brothers and sisters in Christ. Charles Colson, who's heard in most cities of the United States every day on his radio program, sends out an email to thousands and thousands of people every day, has huge effect on the Christian community of the United States. Charles Colson, Richard John Newhouse, who was an apostate from the Lutheran Church, turned Roman Catholic priest, together with two leading Jesuits, Avery Dulles, the famous Avery Dulles, and Juan Diaz Vila, Francis George, and then some Southern Baptists and some other Catholics and archbishops were together in the writing of the text, and then the signing of the text by famous Catholics and famous then evangelicals. J.I. Packer signs it. Just as he had endorsed Keele and Nottingham, he endorsed evangelicals and Catholics together. And the famous Campus Crusade, Bill Bright, I wrote to Bill, and he replied, much to my surprise, defending his decision to accept Catholicism. And Campus Crusade has gone that way. When I was in Poland in the year 2003, it broke my heart to hear Polish Catholics speak of the Catholic Church working intimately with Campus Crusade in Poland. Hand in hand, the Catholic Church working together. That the greatest enemy, for many extents, they said, was Campus Crusade, because their false endorsement of Catholicism had changed many of the Baptist churches' stand on Catholicism. It is really sad to see what happened. But thus it has been, and Mark Knoll, one of the so-called evangelical signers, has since become Catholic and now teaches at Notre Dame University. He teaches at a Catholic university. He was at Wheaton College, a history professor. He now teaches history at a Catholic college. It's a sample of what has happened. And of course, people like the famous Pentecostal ministry, Pat Robertson of the 700 Club, have been on board as well, as we might expect. So it has been widely accepted and, of course, upheld by very famous people, Cardinal John O'Connor, deceased, but when he was Cardinal Archbishop in New York, wasn't it? He upheld it, and many other famous archbishops in the Catholic Church. Another document came out in 1997, evangelicals and Catholics together, the gift of salvation. It was evangelicals and Catholics together, too. I have analysis, and they're on our book table, of these two documents. We get requests for these now, like they just were published now. These have been published many years. This is called the Gift of Salvation Show. It shows how it's a sideshow, how horrendous the document is. And I analyze both documents. We don't have time tonight to go through in detail, but it's horrendous to see what's purported to be the gospel message in these documents and how Catholic it was. But this is what has happened, and this is the apostasy that is right before our eyes, and what has happened in the present day with the defection from Catholicism and going into the Church of Rome, and the apostasy that has happened and that continues to happen before our eyes. The defection has been such that we stand back and are amazed. Now, it has had an effect on nations, on missionaries being sent out to Catholic nations, to Spain, to the Philippines, to African countries, to different Catholic countries across the world. Missionaries to Catholic have been withdrawn because of this decree. I was in contact with a brother near Seville, Malaga, for many years, Robert Coulton, working as a very successful missionary in Spain. He called me from Sacramento when Evangelicals and Catholics Together was first published and when the second one was published. He said that his missionary support had declined. Finally, he emailed me before he left Spain to say that he was returning to the States. An example of many who were missionaries to Catholic nations being withdrawn because people accepted Evangelicals and Catholics Together. And they no longer send out missionaries to Catholic nations because they accept them as Christian nations. And it has affected churches that before stood. My first days as a Christian, when I became a Bible believer and I started the ministry in Portland, Oregon, I worked door to door with the Conservative Baptist Church. I worked with Jerry Brochier as a professor at Western Theological Seminary. I spoke at the seminary for him. And I knew he wanted me to speak because there was an acceptance going on of Catholicism because of this document that had been published. My voice was not heard there. And of course in Denver, the bigger seminary, it wasn't heard there either. When the Pope came to Denver and I went to witness on the streets, I couldn't even get one Conservative Baptist church that would host me to come, or any Conservative Baptist family where I could stay in Denver. They were accepting Catholics already. For the most part, that solid group of Bible believers in the Conservative Baptists have gone under. I was asked on the Conservative Baptist Church on Long Island to give an analysis of why the denomination had gone under. It nearly broke my heart to talk to the pastors and elders at that Conservative Baptist Church that was still standing in Long Island, one of the few. It would break your heart. What had been known before is a lot of First Baptist Community Bible churches that were standing across the United States of America have caved in. These documents have been highly successful in bringing in false ecumenism and acceptance of Catholicism. And so the false evangelical acceptance of Catholicism has had disastrous effects on the gospel going out. And it's the gospel by which people are converted. And has had disastrous effects on missions and on churches that used to stand strong, caving in and now working together with the Catholic Church instead of working to evangelize Catholics. In Denver, when I went out on the streets, the only people I could find witnessing to Catholics were Seventh-day Adventists and one cult. besides that, there was no Bible believers. Before, Bible believers used to witness to Catholics. What about in April when Benedict comes here? Will there be anybody of Bible-believing churches out witnessing? I doubt there'll be even any one group. In the past, it used to be Navigators. It used to be Campus Crusade. It used to be many other groups would be out in flocks witnessing and handing out tracts. They've all gone by the wayside. It is really sad. And it has mostly been the work of Charles Colson and Richard John Newhouse, together with the Jesuits, that put together these documents with them. And then Timothy George of the Founders Movement. It breaks my heart because the Founders Movement is the movement of the sovereign grace, doctrines of grace within the Southern Baptist movement. And he's one of the leaders of that. But he has endorsed Evangelicals and Catholics together. He wrote the covering letter in Christianity Today for the publication of the document. He has strongly upheld it and defended it, just like Packer. He's gone public in defending his stand. He had a conference with John Armstrong, who was a staunch defender of biblical truth. And John Armstrong changed from Reformation and Revival to becoming supporting Christian tradition for the third millennium. He's changed his ministry. He has caved in the famous John Armstrong and his whole movement. Put in Reformation and Revival and you will get his present day website, not his old website, where he defended biblical faith. And this has been Timothy George, one of the people who has upheld evangelicals and Catholics together, and purportedly from the Founders Movement. I have asked other leaders of the Founders Movement to reprimand Timothy George. Of course, they have not replied to my emails. He is untouchable because of his position of president of a theological college and on his different titles. He produces DVDs on history where he whitewashes Catholic history. It is horrendous to see what he does with the Inquisition and some of the other things. A man rewriting history and doing with all the techniques in America to produce a professional DVDs. It is horrendous to see what Timothy George has done and the effect he's having on biblical churches. But so it is, and we grieve of what has taken place. We pray that the Lord would work in spite of all of this, and we know that the Lord is sovereign and he does work. And we trust him in what he does. The Catholic Church has advanced also because of the huge movements that have taken place. These movements have been many, but some of them are the mega church movement and the growth of mega churches in the United States and seeker-friendly churches, where they have a man-made gospel, whereby it's like Frank Sinatra, I did it my way, you know, You make your decision to accept Jesus into your heart, and when you've made your decision and put your stake in the ground, all is well with your soul, so they say. And this man-made gospel in these seeker-friendly churches that have been highly successful. Just look at Olsteen's DVDs when you come out of Walmart, or if you want to pick up one, and see the success of his books and television programs and on, and the mega churches that go on with a false gospel. And sometimes no gospel at all. But this is what is really at stake. I have a DVD online called The Invincible Gospel and the Modern Evangelical Lie, and I get many emails because of that. It's one of the more important DVDs that I've made. But we have had other spin-offs from this, the Rick Warren Purpose-Driven Life, where you find your true self, or you find a doting God who longs to have a relationship with you and is not satisfied till he has a relationship with people. This horrendous depiction of God that is not the God of the Bible, and of finding your true self, and other horrendous teachings in what's called the purpose-driven life. This is just a sample of what goes on in what's called evangelicalism. Apostasy, so that it, in the words of the King James, it stinketh. You know, the King James puts it in stronger English, you can smell the stench. It stinketh. Because it's so far away from the gospel. But it calls itself evangelical. This is what modern day America has come to. And this is why, as a Bible-believing church, you must stand and give the true gospel. And then we have had movements such as the New Perspective. What's called the New Perspective is actually old, because it's going back to inner righteousness and looking for a unity through the covenant. N.T. Wright, James Dunn may have been the initial founders of it, N.T. Wright in the UK, but in the States it was Norman Shepherd in 1997 in Westminster Theological Institute that started to teach this inner righteousness and union with Christ through the covenant, and it became so that the most of the faculty accepted him, and many of the men that they trained are now leading pastors across the United States, trained in this new perspective. It is just apostasy and an old lie of Satan of looking to inner righteousness or to unity through a covenant or some sort of a way, and not by grace through faith and in Christ, which is the gospel message. Horrendous stuff. Done in so clever of a way that it takes a real clever mind to unravel their sophistry. One of the big blossoms or the evil fruits of the New Perspective is probably a better known department of the New Perspective called the Auburn Theology Movement, whereby we have baptismal regeneration accepted as a theological position. And we have famous people of the in the New Perspective, this movement of the Auburn Theology branch of it. We have famous people such as Doug Wilson, who's famous also in the homeschooling movement, Steve Wilkins, Steve Shishel, just to name a few of its leading proponents. Men with massive power and authority, and who have swayed many what had been solid PCA churches and Reformed Presbyterian churches that have gone under and accepted baptismal regeneration and are on a path into Rome, and some of them become Roman Catholic. It has been really sad to see what had been such a solid Presbyterian group going under. When we mention the word Presbyterian, we have to distinguish the free Presbyterians who have been very strong and very consistent with the gospel and are becoming more and more growing in the United States and in Canada, the free Presbyterian churches. They are distinct. They have been aloof from this, and they have exposed this movement. But other Presbyterian churches have in many ways given in. And we have had some leading Presbyterians such as Scott Hond giving in and becoming Roman Catholics. Jeff Cavins, Marcus Grody, Jerry Matetix, just to name a few. People who now have leading ministries to uphold Catholicism, who before, for the most part, were Presbyterian. We have the whole Coming Home network, you find is predominant on the internet and with television programs in many of the United cities in the United States and on the internet, the Coming Home movement, where they show people who have apostatized from Bible-believing churches and have become Catholics, including pastors. They are majoring in showing people who were leading evangelicals who are now Catholics, the Coming Home network. We have a whole group called Christian Churches Together, very much like ECT, has grown out of ECT. Again, a whole movement to bring Christian churches together with the Catholic Church. Then we have the whole movement called the Emerging Church Movement. The Emerging Church Movement is a whole story in itself. I was to give an address on it, and I had to cancel that address. I have written on it, you'll find a DVD I've made on the Emerging Church Movement and Catholic Mysticism on the internet. If you go to our webpage and go to audio and videos, you'll find the DVD on that. It's also on YouTube and other web pages. It is frightening. It is hard to keep up because it's been so successful, not only in the United States but overseas. There are many, many churches becoming emerging churches and entering the emerging church movement. The emerging church movement is a whole movement going back to, they call, ancient Christianity, whereby Christianity was lived in previous years. It is really going back to Christianity that had become apostate in Catholicism and in mysticism and finding direct union with God and without Jesus Christ, communion with God directly by different mystical ways. Lectio Divina, the labyrinth, and many other ways of getting into centering prayer and other ways they have of entering into communion with God directly. Brian McLaren, Tony Jones are famous here in the United States. Alan Jones, who is Dean of Grace Cathedral in San Francisco, supposed to be an Anglican, is a leading proponent, leading the way into re-imaging Christianity, which is going back to Catholicism. It is a horrendous movement, and it's having effect right across France and some of the French nations in Africa. I got a letter from a pastor in Malawi, handwritten, and he was decrying the fact that the emerging church was hitting churches in his area, in Malawi, in Africa, and asking me what should he do about it. I'm now in email contact with the same pastor in Malawi, but just a sample of how the emerging church is touching the world through mysticism and making popular mysticism in ways that are quite modern. Young people can download DVDs on how to have labyrinths and how to have centering prayer to enter into communion with God. All types of horrendous ways taught by Tony Jones. Tony Jones He's supposed to be a youth pastor. He's the coordinator of pastors in the United States of America and speaks in many other nations. Zondervan, that had been a good publishing company, now majors in publishing their books. And they have conferences every year for pastors, where many pastors attend the Zondervan conference to become equipped of how to bring in the emerging church movement into their church. And so few Bible believers have been even conscious of the emerging church movement. It is a lethal coming together of the Catholicism. I really don't have time to go into the Catholic economic policy. You will get it laid out in the notes that I have. But the Catholic Church recognizes that there is really no such thing as private property. But in the words of Pope John Paul II, private property, in fact, is under a social mortgage, which means that it has an intrinsical social function based upon and justified precisely by the principle of the universal destination of goods. The Catholic Church does not, in fact, recognize private property. They talk about a universal destination of goods, that goods really belong to everybody. That is their economic policy, and the policy that is accepted by civil concordat with different nations. And it is lethal, because it leads to stealing. One of the quotations I give is from a Vatican Council document, whereby they say it is all right to take from somebody else's property in questions of needs. I give an exact quotation. In the notes that you will get, you'll get the exact reference to this quotation. Quotation: if one is in extreme necessity, he has the right to procure for himself what he needs out of the riches of others. You have a right to take from the riches of others if you're in extreme necessity. They also purport another principle by which people can take from other people's riches if they see others in need. The Robin Hood principle, that you can rob the rich to feed the poor, so-called. Now this is official Vatican policy. And when we see the amount of congressmen and women who are Catholic in the United States, and we see the politics of guilt and pity come into the United States economic system, when we see the Congress giving in more and more to giving people's wealth to others, and what this could become in a future United States under a new president, it's frightening. Most of our talk show hosts are Roman Catholic, Sean Hannity, Laura Ingraham, and on, with the exception of Rush Limbaugh. But even Rush Limbaugh never brings in the Catholic element. None of them touch it. It is the big element that should be discussed, never discussed. Very few churches will make any declaration on the Christian principles of economics. The only one who has written on the subject is John Robbins, and he's written it splendidly. We have his books with us, some of the copies of his books, Ecclesiastical Megalomania, where he goes to lay out the Catholic principles and shows how damaging they have been to nations of the world. He has Capitalism and Freedom, another book that he has produced recently. How many in this church have read these books? We have to be aware of Christian economic principles and to have a voice in the United States of America, because it's the United States of America, for the most part, leads the nations of the world. And if the United States of America goes under to Catholic teaching of the politics of guilt and pity, much of the world goes under. And so this is the way in which the Catholic Church advances. It advances through these and many other ways, but these are some of the major ways. What is our response to false ecumenism, futurism, the mass production of biblical texts that are not really biblical texts whatsoever, purported translations of the Bible? What is our response to these evangelicals and Catholics together, to the new perspective, to all of the downhill trends in so-called evangelicalism in the United States of America, the seeker-friendly churches, the mega-churches, the man-made gospel? What is our response? Our response is that Christ, our God, reigns. Christ is the head of the church. All power and authority is given to him. He loses none of those that the Father has given to him. All that the Father has given to him shall come to him. Nobody shall snatch him out of his hand. He is sovereign. He rules the nations. He's the head of the church. And Christ Jesus, all power is given and all authority is given. And we have to see it in that perspective. I give the text and the notes that I give, 1 Timothy 6:15. He is blessed and the only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. That's who we see Christ Jesus. He reigns. And he reigns triumphantly over the church, and he is not daunted. In actual fact, he is judging these so-called evangelicals. They're under the judgment of God. And we should see that as it is, some of their lives are lived out. We should see the judgment of God. That Christ Jesus does not take these things lightly, and that these so-called evangelical works are under the judgment of God. The Roman Church, the worldly instrument, the woman that rides the beast, is already condemned, and we know her final end in Revelation 19. But so are the churches that have united and joined hands with her in the dark. So are the Chuck Colsons and the Campus Crusades and the Bill Brights of the world, and the Pat Robertsons who have joined hands in the dark with Rome. Unless they repent, and none of these, as far as we know, have ever repented, unless they repent, J.I. Packer, Oskinus, Timothy George, unless these men repent of their endorsing of Catholicism, they also are not just on the highway into Romanism, but under the condemnation of the Lord God. We have to see that our God reigns, and Christ Jesus is the triumphant head of the church. And we've got to see things in that perspective, and not to be daunted. And we see that there has been the joining of forces in what Scripture calls the unfruitful works of darkness, and particularly here in the United States. The United States has led the way in a lot of this false ecumenism and false mysticism, and joining together with the Catholic Church and in its futurism. The Catholic Church has triumphed for the most part because of so-called evangelicals in the United States. It's for real Bible-believing Christians here in the United States to stand up and be counted, and to contend for the faith once delivered to the saints. And that is my message to you as a church: to contend for the faith and to make your voice known. Do you have your own blog on the internet? If not, repent. Start defending the faith across the world on the internet. You know, if you're a young person and have been typing since your early childhood, you know, as most of these young Americans have, are you defending the faith here as a young person in this church? As an elder in this church, are you defending the church? As a deacon, are you defending the true biblical faith? This is our challenge, and this is what we we have to face. We have to know the history of the defection, going back to such as Billy Graham and Fuller Theological College, some of the first to go under. In this book, Evangelicalism Divided by Ian Murray, he gives the history of 50 years of decline. It is really sad reading, but you've got to know the history of it. You've got to see page after page in this splendidly written book what has happened here in the United States of America. This is a must reading for leaders here in the United States, and to see what has happened in modern times, and to see what has happened. On our own webpage, you will find four articles that we've written on the emerging church movement and many others that I give by other writers, particularly Ken Silva. It's to study some of these and many of the other critiques of the emerging church movement, and it's something that goes on and on. And we have to see just how lethal these groups are. And we have to be biblical separate. We have to call these people what they are, that they are apostates and they're under judgment of God, and to separate from them. The Apostle Paul 10 times names false teachers, even in his letters to Timothy alone. And he tells us to separate from those who teach wrong doctrine. It's a biblical commandment to separate, and not to recognize as Christians those who are not Christians. That we are to separate. Paul to Romans, I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions, which ye have learned, and avoid them. We are to separate from them and avoid them. We are to show that we are not only not working together with the Catholic Church, but we are separate from those who are working together with the Catholic Church, and that we are joining together with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords for the advancement of His kingdom and of His biblical gospel. We know that we have received a kingdom that cannot be shaken or moved, and our God is a consuming fire. We know that God reigns and that His word is truth. We have the infallible word of God, the inerrant word of God in our scriptures, and we are to turn to that. I finish with a beautiful text from 1 John chapter 4, reading from 1 John 4, and where it says, "Herein is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins." Christ was sent to be the propitiation. He was to take the wrath of God, because each of us was born with sin, sin nature, and then we have personal sin. And we need somebody that would take the wrath of God for our sin nature and our personal sin. And in whom, in believing, we could be endowed with, imputed His righteousness. And that's what it means to have the propitiation for sin in His Son. We believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are complete in Him who is the head of all principality and power. Colossians 2:10. We are perfect with the righteousness of Christ. And that's wherein we stand. And that's wherein we contend for the faith, accepted in the Beloved, complete in Him. We are undaunted because we know that He reigns. And we stand to contend for the faith and trust for His kingdom to be more and more manifest in the face of apostasy. That in the midst of wrath He would show revival, as He says in Scripture. We pray for true Bible-believing churches in the face of the apostasy around us, that His light would again shine to show forth the magnificence of Christ Jesus. For the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to all who believe. Amen and amen. Praise God.